Umaga po sa ating lahat. Ilang tulog na lang, eleksyon na. At ngayong umaga, pag-uusapan natin ang isang mahalagang paksa. May kinalaman po ito sa naganap at nagaganap at mukhang magaganap pa sa Davao City. So, for the first part of our tapatan sa Aristocrat today, kasama po natin si Father Amado Picardal. Siya po ay dating tagapagsalita ng Coalition Against Summary Executions sa Davao. Karangalan din pong ipakilala ang dating chairperson, si Professor Loretta and Rosales ng Commission on Human Rights. Mamaya sa part 2, we will introduce our guests appropriately. Okay. Sky, magandang umaga sa iyo.
Nawala naman. Hello, good morning. Good morning po sa inyong lahat. Magandang Monday po at sa ating mga guests for today. It's the first time na magkakaroon tayo ng two parts dito sa Tapatan sa Aristocrat. So napakagandang discussion yung mangyayari ngayong umagang ito. So magandang umaga po ulit kay Professor Rosales and of course Father Picardal. Magandang umaga sa inyong dalawa.
Magandang umaga, Melo. Magandang umaga po, Sky, at magandang umaga ang mga tagapagpanood sa ating Tapatan sa Aristocrat.
Salamat po. Madam, bumati po muna kayo.
Sige. Magandang umaga, Melo. Magandang umaga din, Sky. At magandang umaga, Father, ngayon ko lang kayo nakilala, Father Amado. It's nice to hear it. Magandang umaga sa lahat.
Okay, let's start. Proper perspective, Father Picardal. Bakit lumabas kayo ngayon with this facts and figures about the alleged victims of the Davao Death Squad?
Actually, matagal na kaming calling attention about the killings that has been perpetrated by the Davao Death Squad noon pa. Pero parang hindi pinapansin. No? Sa kami mga investigations na noon, pero walang resulta. Pero we think that this time, this is an election issue kasi. No? This, hindi lang ito a thing in the past, but it's still happening at it will happen in the future. No? The violation of human rights at extrajudicial killings. Kaya especially I was alarmed, no, by the figures. No? Dami talaga ang victims. No? 1,424 na since 1998 hanggang December 2015.
Father, bakit ngayon lumabas to? Sabi nyo na, babanggit nyo na to, pero hindi pinapatulan. Ngayon, sabi naman ng ilan, eh wala na yan eh, dahil mataas na sa rating si Duterte. Are you a Duterte basher in the first place?
It's not just about Duterte. It's about what I could say is mass murder na nangyari sa Davao. And so far, there's been very little outcry at saka no justice has been given to the victims. No? And marami ng mga accusation, no, against the candidate Duterte about human rights violation, about extrajudicial killings, which has been dismissed by a lot of people. No? That's hyperbole. No? Kaya I think it's good to talk about this. No? Dahil he promised na yung 1,000 na pinatay, maging 100,000 yun. At saka tataba po itong mga isda dito sa
Manila Bay.
No? Akala sa iba, that's just a joke. No? For me, it's not a joke. No? Because meron ng mga people who have died. And I am afraid na if he makes good his promise, mas marami pa yan, mas dumadami pa yan. No? Kaya I think it has to be brought out in the open. No? So that people can make a decision based on facts. That's why what we have are actually is mga data. No? Ilan ang pinatay, ang mga age groupings nila. No? So we have this because we've been monitoring this since 1998. No? And we want people to know na this is not just an exaggeration. No? Because you just take, okay, this, pero we have the facts and we have the figures.
Father, do we have the figure kung sa age range, ano yung pinakamarami na pinatay? Anong edad?
Actually, dito, in our data, no, yun po mga minor de edad. No, 17 and below, no, and the youngest was 12 years old, 132.
132?
Oo. Yung mga 18 and up to 25 years old, that is pinaka marami din yun. That is around mga, what we have here is mga 476 young adults, no? Kaya nga, if we total, no, what we have is a profile, no? The victims are mga minor de edad, young people, and belonging to the poor. Mga mahihirap yan. And that we have mga areas where they were killed. Those are urban poor areas, no? And yun, walang no due process, they were just killed, no? Yung iba, small-time criminals lang yun, no?
Father, how did you come to know about the figures? Now, we have to be clear about this.
Meron kaming grupo. No? I was the spokesperson of the Coalition Against Summary Executions. At meron kaming mga groups. No? The task is to monitor, no? Itong lahat ng mga killings. We have a database dito. We started in 1998. At saka I, since I left Davao in 2011, less contact na ko, but I asked for the latest. No? And I was surprised na hanggang 2015 pa rin pala. No? Akala ko when I left Davao na wala na yan. For the last 5 years, 385 ang mga victims. No? 385 ang mga victims, no? Sabi dito na 39 of them are below 17 years old. So mga, these are karamihan mga street children po ito. At saka 118 young adults. So this is still happening. No? The reason why nobody can come out as witnesses, no, is because takot sila, no, na papatayin. No? We have arranged, we have contacts mga former DDS headmen. No? And they gave us all the facts, ano nangyayari. No? And this is also nandun sa report sa Human Rights Watch. No? And nandun din sa result yan sa Commission on Human Rights. No? Walang, nobody is willing to stand up because they're still there. No? If they stand up, pinapatay yan. No? In fact, sa list of those killed, no, yung mga contacts namin sabi, yan sila, former DDS yan, pinatay na yan. No? Because they knew too much at saka takot sila na baka they are going to squeal. No? So we cannot, mahirap talaga to get witnesses will talk. Anong nangyari, how they were trained, who are involved, but they are not willing to stand up in court because they're afraid for them and for their families.
Nakarating to sa gobyerno, sa Commission on Human Rights?
You know, in 2008, they went to Davao, or 7, no? Or 8, they went to Davao, no? And we were the contact of the CSSR, Laila Dilema, no? And they had a public hearing, but besides the public hearing, they met mga witnesses. We provided the witnesses, no? In fact, they got the sworn statements, no? So they have all the data, they have all the sworn statements, no? And we were just waiting, ano ba ang mangyari, no? Because they went there several times, they met a lot of witnesses, no? And we were the ones that arranged for them to meet the witnesses, no? The problem was, I think, there was no action taken, but I think si Madam Eta can answer that. She was not yet the CSSR
chairperson.
But I don't know what happened to the case that was left behind by Chair Laila Dilema.
Yeah, for the record, we invited former chair and now senatorial aspirant Laila Dilema to join us. But I got the number all right, but not a response from her. Siguro walang load. Pero Madam, ano po ba ang inyong nababatid o na karating sa inyong kaalaman tungkol sa Davao Death Squad?
Yeah. Okay, I don't know if there's inquirer dito. Is there an inquirer dito?
Wala pa po.
Wala pa. Pero naimbita ba ninyo? Kasi actually Laila Dilema has called Duterte a monster and it came out in the inquirer very loud and clear in the front pages, no? So, nonetheless, I took over because former Chair Laila De Lima became Secretary of Justice. So I took over, and I don't understand why I never met you, because evidently you were already here in Metro Manila. Nobody ever told me about you, Father. So talagang kung ako, clueless ako. Hindi ko alam na merong ganyan nakatulong pala kay Secretary Laila De Lima nung panahon na yon, si Father Amado. Nonetheless, pinagpatuloy namin yun, and I do have a resolution dito. Ang resolution namin was done in 20, pumasok kasi ako 20, patapos na 2010, so we did investigation 2011, 2012, binigay namin sa ombudsman. And I have the resolution here. It's a resolution that we made very tight, and we only limited ourselves to 200 victims. Salvaging or summary execution. And we deliberately limited ourselves to 200 victims in order to make sure we had a pattern. Yung pattern na nakasakay sa motorsiklo at saka binabarel o di kaya they were being stabbed and so on and so forth. No? So, but at least it's tight, itong resolution na ito. At ang resolution namin, we came out with the fact that talagang out of those who were killed, out of the 200, that there were minors, there were children, and about 19%, I understand, were the minors dito sa aming resolution, particularly. And one of the mothers who testified before Laila's hearing was brave enough to testify. She was warned by the people involved dito sa extrajudicial killings that susunod ang mga anak mo. At sumunod nga yung mga anak niya at mga minors yung mga anak niya. Pero nung pinatay na sila, mga 16, 17, 18. So, makikita mo, nung aming tinignan lahat yung mga transcript of records, we tried to investigate, barangay captains and so on, pinagpatuloy namin yung ginawa ni Laila. Ang lumalabas doon, there was a climate of fear dito sa Davao City. Duterte talks about, oh, I have a clean government, I have a clean city. Ang yabang-yabang ni Duterte kung magsalita. Pero, pag sa ebidensya, makikita mo, may climate of fear. Kung saan, iba-iba ang mga sinasabi nila. There was only one person who admitted that there was a DDS, or the Davao Death Squad, doon sa Davao. It was the Executive Judge Robilio of the Regional Trial Court. Pero pagpakinggan mo yung mga pulis sa mga iba't ibang istasyon, oo nga, mukhang merong vigilante groups eh. Oo nga, mukhang meron. Baka, tapos, pagka pinakinggan mo, no less si Jesus Versosa was the PNP Director General at the time. Sabi niya, mukhang meron. Kasi matindi yung mga naririnig namin. Pagkatapos, pag pinakinggan mo naman yung kwan, regional director, I cannot say that there is a Davao Death Squad, but there's too much smoke, so there must be fire. Anong klaseng mga statements yan na nanggagaling sa kapulisan? Diba kung meron kang naririnig, motto proprio, pag pulis ka at may naririnig ka, uutusan mo kaagad, mag-imbestiga. Ganun dapat ang ginagawa. Pero ito yung nakuha namin na mga... Pagkatapos, merong listahan na kumakalat doon. At ang sabi nung isang regional police, Pedea regional head, sabi niya ganun, yung listahan ko na 43, namatay lahat sila, pero walang kinalaman ng Pedea. Suspects ito na listahan na drug pushers, drug users, and so on and so forth. Pag pinag-aralan mo yung PDEA, Dangerous Drugs Act, walang provision doon na nagsasabi, gumawa kayo ng listahan ng mga suspects. So you can see that they went around the law. I think this is very, very important. And I'm so happy that, you know, Melo, you came out with this press conference because Duterte is a candidate for the presidency. Can you believe it? And he goes around and then he is number one. Siguro dito maraming Duterte fans. Diba? He is number one because he comes out action agad. Gagawin ko ang action. Pero ang tatanungin ko sa inyo, anong klaseng action? At sinabi na naman niya yan kagabi. Sabi niya, lilinisin ko ang droga, lilinisin ko ang krimen, at pati na rin ang tao. Dinagdag niya yun eh. So, he couldn't care less if he orders extrajudicial killings. Because that is his way of cleaning crime, getting rid of crime. That is the law of the jungle. That is the law of the hoodlums. That is uncivilized law. But the people evidently are not able to grasp the importance or the implication of his statements. That's why Laila called him a monster. VP Binay called him Siraulo. Sino pa? Yung mga kandidato na kakompetensya niya. And then Maroha said, that guy doesn't listen to anything. Basta siya ang tama. Kahit anong sabihin mo sa kanya, siya ang tama. Pag pinakitahan mo na siya ng ebidensya, iwas na siya. Iwas pusoy na siya. So, ito ang nararamdaman ko na napakahalagang dapat nating pag-usapan. Nung tiningnan yung listahan, sa batas kasi, pag meron kang listahan ng drug pushers o drug users o mga kabataan, at binibigay daw ng mga nanay yung listahan na yon, maybe some of it is true, some of it is not, pero siguro yung listahan na yon, magandang listahan para sa isang programa ng rehabilitation. Diba? Programa na pagsasaayos sa mga kabataan para magamot sila, para malutas ang problema kung bakit sila nagdodroga. Sapagkat tama si Father, ang mga biktima ng Duterte Law ay ang mga kabataan, young adults, minors, at mga mahihirap. Hindi mo naman naririnig si Duterte ang pumapatay ng mayayaman, malalaking negosyante. Hindi mo naririnig yun. Lahat nang gagaling sa mga maralita. Kaya yung mga maralita at yung mga kabataan na gusto siyang maging presidente, paano kung yung inyong kamag-anak, paano kung yung inyong nanay o yung tatay ninyo o di kaya yung anak ninyo ang susunod sapagkat kayo ay galing sa mahihirap. Ito siguro ang dapat natin.
Thank you. Let me ask you, Father. May binanggit si Professor Eta. May kinalaman ito dun sa isang ina na binalaan at pinatay yung mga anak. Do you have the same data?
Yeah, kilala ko yun. Si Clarita yun eh. Clarita Alia. No? At saka, when I left Davao, ako ang naglibing sa kanyang pangatlong anak. No? Si Fernando, meron pang isang natira at saka talagang pinayuhan siya. No? He worked under Ana Alice. No? Sa syudad at saka mag-aral. No? And he left siguro around 2 years nag-aral, naging matino. Eh, felt homesick. Umuwi. Akala niya okay na siya. Pag-uwi, pinatay pa rin. No? So, ang latest is yung kapatid na isang madre. No? Pinatay in front sa kanyang tatlong anak at saka sa kanyang mother. At saka ang anak nang makaawa, huwag po yung patayan ang tatay namin. Pinatay pa rin. No? So, these are not just figures. These are stories na nangyayari. No? Ako, I was saying mass at one time sa Redemptorist sa Davao, kasal yun. I heard shots outside sa parking area. Pagkatapos ng misa, lumabas ako, nakikikatalo doon. Siguro mga 16 years old, no? Patay na. No? Sabi ko, nangyari dito. sabi sa mga kuan kasama pinatay daw ng DDS, no? May pulis pang malapit, no? Nandoon lang, no, police car. At saka ang mga pulis nagpaputok lang in the air, parang as if warning lang para makaalis ang mga DDS. Anong ginawa nito? Bakit pinatay ito? Kasi 2 weeks earlier, may binasag na window sa isang sasakyan at may ninakaw doon. Sa aking isip, okay, kung nagawa niya yon, masama yon. Okay, they should have arrested that person. No? Bakit patayin? No? Kasi para sa akin, killing is worse than stealing. No? No? At saka kung nagnakaw yan, dapat dakpin yan. Bring that person to court. No?
Okay. So, you know the mother. No? You know the mother and you even presided over the burial of the third. And then the fourth son left and studied, reformed himself, returned to Davao, but was eventually killed. What do you think was the reason this fourth son was killed?
Kasi meron siyang listahan. No?
Pag-English lang po, may foreigner tayong bisita.
Because they have a list. No? And you know, even if you leave Davao, no? As long as your name is on that list, patay ka pa rin. You're still a...
Doesn't matter if you're innocent or not.
Doesn't matter. No? Hindi na-erase ang kanyang pangalan. The name was not probably erased. You don't know what happened. But as long as they saw him na nandoon siya, he was there and he was a target. No? So that was the reason. He was still on the list. No?
Professor, when you learned of this, when you were chair of the Commission on Human Rights, how did you feel about it? Because you even came out with a resolution.
Actually.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Okay, fine. Of course, I was disgusted. That's why Duterte doesn't like me. You know, he.
And the feeling is mutual.
Of course. I mean, I have nothing against a person, but you know, the acts and the audacity, the temerity, the arrogance. You know, as a mayor, na pinagmamalaki. He even brags about the kind of law that he employs, which is the law of the jungle, uncivilized law. We finished this resolution, and I gave it to the ombudsman. This was 2012. I was able to talk to the ombudsman later. The ombudsman acted on the resolution, but filed cases administratively against the policemen, because our resolution actually said that Duterte is liable. He is liable administratively. I don't have evidence to show that he ordered the killings. Okay? So that's criminal, because if you ordered the killings, that's criminal. But he was liable administratively because he omitted. It was a crime of omission. It was a he did not order investigation of the killings that were going on under his nose, beside the precincts. He did nothing about it. So he was administratively liable. So we brought it to the ombudsman. And at that time, there was this doctrine. It was a condemnation doctrine called Aguinaldo Doctrine, which was used by them because Sara was the mayor at the time. And Sara met with me when I went to Davao City to push through with this investigation. And she said, "Ma'am, I want us to do something right about this because I really believe in clean governance." Ganun din si Sara, no? So, but 2013, Duterte, the father, ran for office. Nanalo uli, di ba? He was re-elected. Because he was re-elected, and this was under investigation, the Aguinaldo Doctrine or the Condemnation Doctrine was operational and it nullified whatever, you know, pending charges there were against a person who is re-elected. So, nangyari, libre si Duterte kasi re-elected siya. Landslide victory siya sa Davao. Pero yung kanyang mga kapulisan were charged administratively, but were given light sentences and so on and so forth. Now, yung Aguinaldo Doctrine na yan has been repealed by the Corte Suprema. And that is found in the Junjun case. That's why Junjun, mayor of Makati, has now been charged because Junjun used the Aguinaldo condonation doctrine. Para ganun. So, ngayon, hindi na pwedeng gamitin ni Duterte ito. But he is running for office, and if we can show that the 2015, I mean post-2015, any continuing extrajudicial killings that take place will actually have to be considered. But it will all, it will have to be post-2015 because the Supreme Court nullified the condonation doctrine, the Aguinaldo doctrine, only in 2015. Yun.
Okay, so that explains. Father, is there any link between the mayor and the death squad? Or did the death squad did it on their own?
Most of these are circumstantial, di ba? He reads a statement, pagkatapos, after 2 weeks, patay yung mga binasa niya. No? So parang it was like a warning. No? And he boasts about it. No? And at the same time, na may mga program siya. At one time, sabi niya, ako ang death squad. Then after na next week, DDS means, ano yun, develop Davao development system. No? But if you look at the logic, no, and our conclusion is that the extrajudicial killings by the DDS is at the centerpiece of the war against crime. No? Because what ano pang ibang ginawa? No? So if we speak about, yeah, peaceful law ang Davao, it's because of the climate of fear. You have death squads that is operating, no? Pero, no? And that's why sa Human Rights Watch, sa mga witnesses, there are mga links, no? And that's why that even ngayon sa DOJ, they said that meron daw silang isang witness, no? Under witness protection program, no? That links meron pang iba. I have met several mga former DDS hitmen na nagsabi, no, that he was present, no. Yun lang, they cannot come out in the open para mag-testify because patay kang bata ka, no? He will be killed, no, and that is always the problem, no. There are people who can testify directly, ang direct links niya. And even those who inspired, hindi, it's not just Duterte. No? We have data, we have, pero it's all hearsay as long as hindi sila lalabas. No? Sinong nag-umpisa, who are the links, who are the financiers? No? Pero that will remain dito at dito because yung sources are not willing to stand up. No?
Okay, so there are financiers.
Meron.
Itong mga death squad.
Because it's not free. Every hit, meron yan. You spend 50,000 to 100,000 per hit. No? According to the Human Rights Watch, and we also had this information before, every project, it's called project kasi eh. No? Every project, mean every hit, there is kwan yan eh, yung meron niyang pera, no, nagagastuhin. No? Part of that is para sa mga hitmen, mga kwan, at saka yung mga handlers. No? According to Human Rights Watch, the handlers are policemen at saka former policemen. No? Malaki ang cut nila. No? So there's money involved, but who is, saan galing ito? No? We know where it is coming from. No? But sa ngayon, we are not going to make it public. No? But the time will come. No, darating talaga yan, no? Na as long as yung mga witnesses are willing to stand up there when they feel safe, that will tell, no? Yung iba nga is there is a haka-haka, no? Remember that there are ilan yon, 11,000 contractual workers in the city hall, no? Most of those at the mayor's office. That's 708 million a year, no? Sabi ng COA, there is no accountability sa niyang pumupunta. Sabi na 80% of those could be ghost employees. No? You put two and two together. No? Who are those ghost employees? You make your own conclusion.
So they're into the ghost industry. Dahil nawawala, I don't know, pero sa tingin niyo ba, Professor?
Just call me Eta.
Ah. Always a professor. Yung bang ganito sa Davao lang, confined, o meron ding ibang lugar?
No, umikot na nga yan eh. They are inspired. There are some mayors, you know, who have this thing that they were inspired by, ganyan pala, how to get rid of crime, patayin mo na lang, just kill the people, without due process at all, no? So there are a number, remember this, was it Iloilo ba yun? This guy who, he came out in the news, the mayor, who said he was inspired by Rodrigo Duterte. So he had this guy march all over the marketplace. I am a magnanakaw. I am a thief. I'm a thief. Remember in the marketplace? Was that in Iloilo? One of these mayors, anyway. So you can see that it goes around and they are inspired. And yung mga utak pulbura ng mga kapulisan or these guys who are trigger happy, mga policemen, are inspired by Duterte. Look at the patterns. They have lists. And then, strangely enough, you know, everybody was saying it was a PDEA list. But PDEA, the PDEA Act, does not provide for coming out with a list. Then one police station commander said, no, it's not just the PDEA. We have another list. So talagang naglilista. And the lists are given to the barangay captains. Yung mga barangay captains ang may hawak ng mga listahan. No? And then voila, in the urban poor areas, they disappear. The children disappear. So there is a pattern. And what about the social, the DSWD at the local level? If there is a list of suspects and, you know, petty criminals, young kids who nagnanakaw, who steal, and so on and so forth, don't you think this should be the focus of the DSWD? He talks about clean government. What kind of government apparatus does he have? What kind of provisions? We are a state party to 8 of 9 international human rights treaties. One of them is the ICCPR, the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. They have a committee there that looks into this matter. In fact, the special rapporteur for extrajudicial killings, Philip Alston, way back in 2007, came to the Philippines specifically to look into one of the things, the Davao Death Squad. And he said, it is only in Davao that you can see that it is officially sanctioned because these guys who commit summary executions don't even bother to hide their faces. The these guys who threatened Clarita never bothered to hide their faces. So they do that openly. So you can say that it is officially sanctioned. This came from the Special Rapporteur for Extrajudicial Killings. We have international human rights organizations that all of these things can probably be looked up to because they can look into the matter. They do not have police sanctions. They do not have the force of law. But definitely, you can bring it to them. And the people should understand. More than anything else, para sa akin, ako ay appeal to the people. Hindi naman tayo ganyan eh. Hindi tayo mamamatay tao. We are not killers. We do not believe. I think it's correct what was said by, you know, some of the candidates before. In last night's one, where there are more Filipinos, you know, the EDSA, people who fought against the dictator Marcos, who actually launched a revolution, non-violent, in fact, who faced the tanks. These were people who believe in the rule of law, in human rights law. And I think this is the message that should, in fact, be addressed. I am going to leave you a resolution to give you an idea of how, you know, we tried to make it as tight as possible because the whole point, the whole message here, Melo and Father, I think, is the message of the rule of law, respect for the rule of law, which is that of a civilized society. And what is the rule of law? When you talk about the rule of law, you talk about human rights law, which is respecting our human rights, our right to life, our right to development, our right to education, our right to human security. Diba? Hindi tayo natatakot. Our right against fear to free expression. That's just one set of laws. There is also the rule of law, which is criminal law, which means that you have to go through due process. You don't just kill people when there is no evidence. We don't even have capital punishment in the Philippines. It is suspended. So, you kill is against the law because the highest punishment should be reclusion perpetua or life in imprisonment. That's criminal law. What about civil law? What about the rights, the civil rights of the persons? No? The damages committed, like the mothers, the mothers whose children have been killed, yet they are so scared. The rule of law is a principle of governance. Melo, it's a principle of governance that says that every individual, whether public or private, every group, and even the state institutions and even the state itself, we are all accountable and we are all responsible to the compliance of laws that are publicly promulgated, objectively enforced, independently adjudicated, and are consistent with international human rights standards. That is a principle of governance. Evidently, our dear friend, Mayor Rodrigo Duterte, doesn't understand this. So I think the Filipino people should rise up and call for civilized society and a human, and choose their people, you know, choose their candidates.
Mm-hmm. Father, they say that men of the cloth are prophets and they will rise up, they will stand to say their piece, especially when it's against the law. Did you ever feel threatened when you were in Davao?
Well, there were some friends who called me to be careful, no, because yes, the mayor is already angry at me, and in fact, he attacked me verbally in his TV program. No? The reason why I became a spokesperson is because, according to my companions, wala naman akong pamilya. No? I don't have a family, so. Well, I accept that that's one of the blessings of being a celibate. No, I don't have to be afraid of anything. No, I'm actually I know that I'm taking risk in doing this. No, but I will take the risk. No, because I've given my life to God. No? Anytime kung kukunin nila ako, I'm there. No, well, am I afraid? No, because I have faced death several times na. No, I was arrested, tortured, and imprisoned during martial law, the first years of martial law. I was tortured for 1 week, at saka yung I thought I was going to be killed because they put that yung 45 was put in my mouth. No, one of the effects of being tortured is I have lost the sense of fear, no? Because I know the worst that could happen to me. No, so I'm not afraid of that. No, so I don't know kung because. At least ngayon, I don't know kung anong what's going to happen. No? But at least I am doing what I need to do and I know the risks that are involved. No? But this is our task. No? It's a prophetic task. No? Whoever is in power, no? Whether Duterte wins, we will be there. No? We will not remain silent. No? We will not remain silent. Any abuses, no, of human rights, any injustice na nangyayari, no, we will stand up.
I would like to ask Professor and Father, no, kayong dalawa, How do you see the Philippines in the next 6 years pag nanalo itong...
Si Duterte?
Si Duterte.
Bakit naman si Duterte? Ayoko ba?
With all your experiences nung martial law, nung with all the data
exactly.
On the day.
Precisely. That's why I'm appealing to the Filipino people, for heaven's sakes. Diba, martial law, never again. Yung mga, those of you who have not experienced martial law, I'm a torture victim, so I know what I'm talking about. That's why I can deal with the military and the police anytime. Because they can't hide anything from me. I have no agenda. I have no agenda. So I deal with them straight. And they're very, they deal with me straight also. But I appeal to the Filipino people. I don't want to anticipate that Duterte will win and what are we going to do if Duterte wins. No, I'd rather let's campaign against Duterte. And that's an appeal even to the media. Of course, I don't know how you think. Pero ako naman naniniwala ako na hindi naman tayo nag-iisa eh. No? Naniniwala ako, a lot of you people know what democracy is all about, know what human rights is all about. And I think that we should fight for candidates that are clean, candidates that do not kill or do not believe in killing, candidates that do not believe in stealing, killing and stealing, candidates that, in fact, are ready to serve the nation and the people. So I don't want to anticipate what are we going to do, etc., because I'd rather campaign against Duterte.
Father.
Well, I am very realistic, no? Nangunguna siya sa survey, no? So I wouldn't be surprised if he wins, no? But whatever, because I already have what we call worst case scenario, no? Because he already telegraphed his intentions, no? One of this is na dadami ang mga death squads, no? Because he promised 3 to 6 months criminality will be eliminated. How do you do that, no? If you use the rule of law, you're still you have to case build up. So what he did in Davao, yan para gagawin, no? This is what he did to do na nadami ang mga death squads, no? In fact, they're not just in Davao, but they're already in some cities, no?
Based, I heard even Tagum already had.
Actually, there is already a case filed against Mayor Uy in Tagum. Here in Luzon, in a city in Batangas, whose name I will not, you can guess, know where it is. It is happening, no? In Mindanao, meron din yan sa other cities, no? Northern Mindanao, Cebu, there was one time they were there. Ito po is madali lang ginawa. How did they do that? Is what you call franchise method. Diba? Alam yung McDo, diba? No? Meron silang specialist, and the mayor says, we are going to start this. Then they send their guys there to train them. No? And this is what I heard. No? It cannot be, nobody will stand up to testify. No? But I have personal knowledge, no? Of this. No? This is how they do it. It's like franchise, no? To train local people. You prepare the hitmen. We will train them, no? So this is my fear, no? Na yung 1,000 plus will become 100,000, no? This is not a boast, no? That's if you want to do wage war using extrajudicial killings, ibig sabihin yung DDS, no? It will become a nationwide marami na yung mga branches in major cities, no? What I will tell you is this, no? The next 6 years, God forbid, if he becomes president, it's going to be turbulent years. No? Because he cannot just impose his will on a whole nation. He can do that in Davao. There will be civil society against him. The church will be against him. And he cannot rely on the loyalty of the military. No?
And the police.
because the police, some of the police, that is a pattern. He can work with the police, especially those not with the whole police PNP, no? Because there are still mga professionals, no? But all you need if you operate with a death squad is not everyone, no? Meron lang mga iba station commanders, no? Kasi may pera yan eh, no? What I fear is that the next 6 years, if ever, no, is going to be turbulent years, no? And if you have civil society against you, the church against you, and if you cannot rely on the military, it will be an unstable government. He promised to close down Congress and declare revolutionary government, di ba? No? If ever they stand on his way. There's no legal basis for that. So what is going to happen? A constitutional meron yang kwan, stalemate. No? Because there is no legal law that where a president can do anything he likes. Di ba? No? So, you know, there's going to be a, you know, sabing may mga pagbabago, no? He cannot do it on his own, no? But if he promised to do the things that he wanted to do, malamang is going to be troublesome, no? He promised a coalition government with the CPP, no? Okay yan ang peace negotiations, but once you do that, a coalition government, again, it will, yung mga anti-communist segments within the military, it will, right now, I know na marami na ang galit sa kanya within the military, no? No? Because of his statements favoring the NPA, no? Mga YouTube, yung mga kwan na yung mga mabuhay ng NPA, lumalabas na yan. Him telling mga businessmen na you just pay the revolutionary taxes. He's creating a lot of enemies within the military. Yung iba, they're calling him a traitor, no? So, you know, this is going to be very turbulent if ever he comes to power, no? He okay. Cannot govern smoothly.
All right, madam.
Siguro, just look at one thing, no? I've talked to the, you know, diplomatic community, some people, no? And then and in Europe, because in my kind of work, we deal with people outside of the Philippines. And they used to tell me, Hitler, during his time, during his early years, would crack jokes at the expense of the Jews. He would make fun of the faces of the Jews, their big nose, their yan. He would make fun of the way they deal with money and with businesses. And the people would laugh. And the people would support him even if he came out with very sick jokes against the Jews. And this went on and on and on. And finally, when Hitler finally felt that he had the crowd within the palm of his hand, that's when he started hitting. And you know what happened. Children, adults, we know what happened to 6 million Jews in Germany during Hitler's time. The father talks about it in specifics. But do we want that kind of atmosphere? Do we want that kind of climate? I think this is something that we should take into account. No, we should very, very seriously consider, because we believe in justice, we believe in democracy, we believe in the rights, the right to free information, di ba kayo? Free information. We believe in the right of our wives and mothers and children, no? Not to be exploited and not to be abused, etc.
You know. Thank you. We will open the floor to our friends from the media for the first portion. Yes, please. May tanong yung ating kasama. Teka, pakilapit lang sa mikropono. Sino magtatanong? Ito yung mikropono. Ayan, si Ernie.
Sa Ernie Reyes po sa interaction ng TV. Hello, hello, hello. Ernie Reyes po sa interaction.com ng TV5. Marami na tayong accusation kay... Bakit? Marami na accusation daw, sabi nga ni Father, kay against Duterte. At alam naman natin na medyo talagang nangyayari yung ganun sa Davao City. Pero ang tanong po, bakit hindi natin siya kinakasuhan sa human rights?
Sinagot ko yun, ano? May resolution kami. I just, binigay namin sa ombudsman, kinasuhan namin siya. He is administratively liable. Wala akong ebidensya na nakuha na siya yung nag-order, that he ordered, you kill them, etc. I don't have that kind of evidence. But my evidence was that he failed to order, as the highest government official in the city government, he failed to order and instruct the policemen to investigate the crimes that were being committed under his nose. So he was administratively liable. So I explained that. And the ombudsman said, that was 2012, we gave that resolution. And this resolution, according to the ombudsman, was processed and they investigated only the police because there was the condonation doctrine that operated with respect to Duterte. This is the Aguinaldo doctrine. Aguinaldo, as former governor of Cagayan de Oro, when he was re-elected overwhelmingly, I believe, so that whatever charges against him of mutiny were nullified. So that doctrine operated when Duterte was re-elected in 2013. But his policemen were administratively charged and convicted with, you know, light crimes and so on and so forth. So yun ang sagot ko. Inaksyonan namin.
Hinaman niya ba nga na before, bakit hindi niya siya kasuhan? Bakit katulad ng si dating CSSR chair na Dilima and you, sinahaman?
Ito na, sinasagot ko. Kinasuhan namin. Ito na sa ombudsman na ito. At it was processed.
Can we not use the report of the United Nations Human Rights na as against Duterte? Kasi sila nag-data eh. Sila nag-document ng mga killings doon. Can we not use that against Duterte?
Well, who will... No, no. Kami kasi, you have to have evidence, facts, and figures. So, the most that we were able to get was administrative liability. I did not have evidance that, syempre, Duterte naman is smart, no? He's a lawyer. Di naman niya sasabihin and put it in black and white that order the killing of this and that. Although ngayon, he openly says, I believe in killing people to get rid of criminality and so on and so forth, you know? But you have to have that kind of evidence in order to be able to charge him of criminal liability. So, there's a difference between criminal law and administrative law. What we were able to do was administrative liability because that was what... I only got this from, you know, former Chair Laila de Lima because I took over as chair of the commission and she became chair.
Last na lang po kay Father. Father, sabi niyo nakakatakot na maging presidente si Duterte. Since na naman yun na yung mga ganong klase na ginagawa niya, including the CSR, mga report ng CSR, report ng United Nations Rapporteur on Human Rights Violation, bakit hindi natin na-inform yung publiko on that point? Na hanggang ngayon, parang dinudyos na siya. Diba? Marami na siyang nahahatak because nakikita nila kay Duterte yung kailangan ng leader na matapang, action agad. Parang yung desperado na yung taong bayan, lalo na yung mga nasa DNE. Mas marami siya doon sa DNE. So desperado na siya. So saan nagkulang, particular yung ating lipunan, particular yung simbahan, na inform yung taong bayan o yung kabataan na ito yung ginagawa niya, ito yung nangyari.
Okay, before answering that, no, yung bakit no case can be filed, yung sinabi ko na, no, merong mga tao na talagang who can witness but they are not willing to testify dahil because of takot. They're afraid, no? Meron, hindi yan nagkulang, but they cannot testify, no? Yung question, yun ang what is frustrating for us. We're like mga small boys crying in the wilderness kasi may mga tao na walang sense of, walang konsensya, no? What is right and wrong. They think that as long as peaceful ang aming city, okay lang patayin yan ang mga kabataan. Anyway, mga mahirap yan. Anyway, wala yan silang mga kwenta, no? Okay, may frustration about very slow ang ating judicial process. But it does not mean that because it is very slow, then we get rid of that. Because otherwise, once we get rid of that, we will have chaos and disorder. Kasi kung merong, if you feel bad, no? Okay, hindi kailangan punta sa korte, papatayin mo lang yan. No? So we are creating more crimes. No? We are using criminal means in order to fight criminality. And that should not happen in a civilized society. No? You know, we have always preached about the value of life. Diba? No? Ang problema kasi, marami mga Pilipino, no? Hindi nag-iisip. No? Walang sense of right and wrong, no? Kaya nga, para bang, that's why I always say, once you elect someone who promises to kill, ikaw nag-elect, you're also an accomplice. No? Pero, marami kasing iba na seduced na eh, no? No, parang, okay, kasi we want shortcuts, no? We want change, no? And they think that there is someone who can save the Philippines, who can change the Philippines. It cannot be done by one person, by one president, no? Dapat change has to begin within ourselves, no? And kung meron mga officials na magbabago, dapat sa kanilang sarili mag-umpisa ang pagbabago, no? Because you cannot change society if you yourselves marami kang mga kasalanan.
Okay. No? Well said, madam.
I just want to say something, no? I think this is a principle that is universally accepted and recognized by lawmakers and executives and leaders. It's commonly recognized and accepted that when you instill fear and authoritarianism in governance, you do not make the place safer. You only make its citizens weaker. What happened in Davao City, and perhaps even up to now, is that the citizens and even the law enforcers are weak. They are scared. There is a climate of fear because the law of fear and control is what prevails in the city of Davao. And Father says, you elect him president, that fear at a small, you know, micro level will become the climate at a national level. And we cannot afford that.
Okay. Thank you.
Ma'am, ako si Pat Santos po. Pat, Tribune. Ma'am Eta, tsaka Father. Are you aware of the PIDEA data? 96% infested ang Metro Manila barangays ng drugs. Aware po kayo doon? Yung re-release na data, which is alarming. Ano? Maraming mayor pumalag. Pero the reality of ano, yung truth sa baba. Katulad ko po ako, isa taga-Sampaloc ako. I think I'm most inclined to believe may katotohanan eh. Kasi po, one out of sa 10 kabataan, even katandaan, ano, siguro I can say 6 are drug dependents or users na makikita mo parang okay na lang, abutan na lang. Yung poser just casually walk, may dalang ano, may text. Are you not, ano, tungkol sa side na yun, sir, na father, na I think yung mama na yun, sa isang panig. Although mali, ano? Minsan ang mali nagiging tama. Pag gusto mong itama, yung napakamalaking mali. Can we weigh that
thing? Okay.
Sa pananaw niyo po, alisin natin legal, alisin natin yung politika. Yung reality of how do you control?
Yeah.
How do you...
Yeah. You can never resolve
nga po,
a problem.
By creating another problem. I know you will
answer that. By creating another problem or by the same level of consciousness that created that problem. Hindi pwedeng yung kung ano yung kaalaman mo. In other words, you do not commit a crime in order to resolve that crime. Diba? So, hindi pwedeng ganun yon. Ang kailangan, yung criminal justice system, at tama yung tanong ninyo eh, hindi lang naman Davao City ito. Diba? Hindi lang Davao City ito.
Buo na, sabihin na natin.
Oh, marami sa atin. At saka, yung Metro Manila, alam ko na lumala, pero hindi ko alam na umabot sa 96%.
Yun po yung data.
Yun ang data na galing sa PDEA. Pero ang nakikita kong kwandya, kasi pinag-aralan ko yung PDEA law, ang PDEA law, saklaw ang media, saklaw ang mga eskwelahan, ang simbahan, ang mga institusyon, kaya ang kabataan, kaya ika kung ganun, ang problema ay hindi pagpapatupad, lubos at ganap na pagpapatupad ng batas as it is. Tinignan ko yung Dangerous Drugs Act with all this amendment. Kung ganun ang gagawin natin, kunin natin, ang media pumupunta sa akin, nung chair ako, paano kong nailabas? How was I able to expose abuses by the Philippine National Police? Media nagsusumbong. At hindi lang media. Kung hindi, yung mga kadete mismo nagsusumbong. Yun ang dapat sa atin. Monitoring system. Yun.
Hindi po, I believe dalawa po yung approach eh. Law enforcement at saka economic. Yung iba, yung mga
economic, tama.
Tumatakbo na po sa frustration. Just they want to get away with for a day, tapos na to. Tira na tayo muna. Wala nang kain.
The politics of money. Oo, the use of money.
Hit-hit na lang tayo, di ba?
Okay.
Actually, it's not just a national problem. It's a global problem. No? All over the world po ito eh. From US, Mexico, Latin America, hanggang sa Pilipinas. Lately, meron pong international gathering, no, na to rethink the strategy. Kasi yung ginagamit is war on drugs using military force. And they realize that it is not effective. No? Kasi it's a social problem, it's economic problem, at saka it even involves, pati yung mga nandoon sa police, they're also involved in gumagamit din eh, no? So you cannot just solve it by just killing sa mga suspects eh. Oo. Yeah. Kaya nga meron kwan, there's a recent article that says that they are moving from that approach of tarang gera. No, because you cannot use gera, no? Hindi eh. How do you deal with, kasi if there is a demand, then there is a someone will provide the supply, no? At saka kaya nga, the more you use violence against them, yun nangyari sa Mexico, the more violent ang response. No? You're creating a lot. Hindi, may pera yan. They can raise their own private armies. Eh, no?
Yeah.
Kaya nga, sabi na nila, you cannot use force against drugs. But yeah, we have to admit that we have to address this problem, but you cannot use force. Hindi
alone.
Hindi pwedeng papatayan yung lahat. No?
Okay. Father, ang sabi nila, pag may ukay-ukay, may droga. Dahil lang sa yung ukay-ukay is just a byproduct of the drugs which cannot be detected by the dogs because used clothes have preservatives which will confuse the dogs. And drugs may come in as, you know, part of the shipment ng onions and garlic which is also smuggled in the Philippines. Question from the media. May taga Channel 5, Linggoy. Sandali, paunahin muna natin, sir. Sandali lang po.
Thank you, sir.
The small boys in front.
Magandang umaga po sa ating panelist. Obviously, your campaign against Duterte to be in Malacanang. But he is now leading the survey. At konting-konti na lang, malapit na sa Malacanang kung tutuuman yung survey. At napakalaki, umaalagwa at lumalayo siya doon sa mga kalaban niya. Oo, at napakarami pa ho, ano nga talagang para nag-a-adore na dito kay Duterte. Now, baka may message po kayo for those Filipino who are saying, I am a Filipino and my president is Duterte.
Father, you know, it was clarified by the good priest kanina. He's not here against Duterte. But please, reiterate.
You know, I am a Filipino and I follow my conscience. Yan talaga ang sana nating sasabihin. No? Dapat gamit natin yung konsyensya, alam natin anong tama at saka ano ang mali. No? Yun lang. Eh. Kung alam natin na killing our fellow Filipinos, pati suspects, is mali, then why do we support that? No? So we cannot use, the end does not justify the means because we have to be a civilized society. No, we cannot destroy our democracy. We cannot destroy our rule of law. We cannot violate human rights in order na may pagbabago. No? So do not immediately say that dahil ako Pilipino, bubuto ako ganito. No? Ako ay Pilipino and I will do the right thing. And I know what is right and I know what is wrong. Yun lang ang sagot ko. Yeah.
Father, dagdagan ko lang yung tanong niya. Eh, meron daw kasing opinion yung mga Pilipino that this government was a student government. Eh, yung problema nga lang ng train, eh, hindi malutas eh. Kaya, they would rather have someone like Duterte who can work miracles, quote unquote.
Again, let us go back to Davao. No? Because yung sabi na Davao is a paradise is not true. No? Hindi po paradise ang Davao. There is a paradise island at sa beach resort. No? Oh, what is the latest? Even yung criminality, no? After all these years, Davao is still number 4, no? Sa criminal total crime index, no? Number 1 sa murder, number 2 sa rape, no? Kaya nga sinasabi ko dito na if there are 1032 murder in 5 years at saka 843 rape incidents in 5 years, no? It's a myth magsasabi ka na there is already peace and order sa Davao. No? At saka you say that you can have a supplementary in 3 to 6 months. Even 6 years is not, hindi yan kaya. No? So, that's why that you will always look at facts. No? Because sometimes we put just puro mga belief, no? Ako ay I believe that ito mangyayari kung siya ang may pagbabago. If you can't even have a complete pagbabago sa Davao, no? Even yung what you call anti-corruption, no? Because of the obsession against crime, no? Corruption has not been addressed. I know that very well, no? I've been living in Davao for 20 years. Maraming corruption. Even those who come to confession, no? They may dilemma sila. And how will I do it even in my own office? Everybody is doing it. No? I know maraming mga corrupt practices. No? So don't tell me na walang corruption sa Davao. No? Meron. No? I know. No? Pati yung gym sa barangay, it's supposed to be only 3 million, naging 7 million yan. No?
Thank you.
Can I just say something? Kasi it's a good question, no? What is our message? I think it has been shown quite squarely and succinctly na you cannot solve the problem with another, you know, you don't solve the crime with another crime. But I think what is important here is my message to the Filipino people who find Mayor Duterte's approach a viable approach in order to solve the crime of crimes, especially drug-related crimes. The point is, it is not true. It is not true that crimes have been solved in Davao. We are using the Philippine National Police Crime Index. And I think that's about the most objective, neutral index that we can use. Tama yun, papaulit-ulit yung sinasabi. I just don't have the absolute figures. Number 4 sa crime rate, number 2 sa murder, number 1 sa rape. And what are the absolute figures? In other words, Mr. Duterte is not telling the truth. So that is the first thing that we should know. Number 2, equally strong, Mr. Duterte, you are not even telling the truth, you are lying through your teeth. You are committing crimes and you have the gall to say that you are willing to commit a crime in order to solve the problem. So, sino ang nabe-benefit yan? It is his ego. I'm afraid that Mr. Duterte is narcissistic. You know, he feeds his ego and he believes in himself so much. This is what is happening to him. And I think that the Filipino people then should learn not to rely on their emotions, but to go into evidence, to understand facts and figures, and to pursue the truth. To be able to do that, you have to study. You have to study and not just rely on emotions.
Okay. Yes. Next question, Linggoy. Thank you.
Magandang umaga po. Linggoy Alquas of Opinion Weekly Magazine. Just a comment. Yung aming weekly opinion, naniniwala sa fair play. Kaya po, dahil dati parang pro-Duterte, ngayon ay naging pro-Rojas. Huwag nyo isipin na iba ang dahilan. Since malaki po ako, malaki rin yung tanong ko. Okay. Ang preface lang. Ang preface ko ay, ako po ang manunuri na nanunuri nung 15-year cycle. In short, pag binilang nyo how many years from EDSA 1 to EDSA 2, 15 years. From EDSA 2 to 2016, eh 15 years rin po. Ako naman po ay hindi numerologist. So I don't mean to say exactly 15. Ang ibig sabihin, para sumabog ang isang bagay, kailangan mag-build up yung pressure. So it doesn't have to be 15, it can be 14, 13. Pero ang ibig sabihin, kung taon-taon magre-revolusyon, taon-taon magpi-people's power, taon-taon magkuku, hindi po pwede yon. Kasi kailangan mag-build up yung pressure. Oh, si Eta agrees with me. Okay. Number 2. Nung 6 months ako, ako po ay naniniwala. Kasi pag sinabi niyong magkakagulo, sabi ng mga tao, hindi, pase na ang ku. Hindi, pase na ang people power. Pase na yung revolusyon. Ang sinasabi ko po ganito, pag nagkaroon ng confluence of interests and events, dati po ang paniwala ko ay baka magsama-sama ang interest ni Vice President Binay, ni Senator Po at ni Mayor Duterte kung dayain sila ng administrasyon at sasama na rin ang iglesia sa kaguluhan. Dahil nakita naman ng iglesia, pag sila ay humarap sa Sio Boulevard, ang iglesia basta kumilos ng hindi underground, talo. Pero pag underground ang kilos, meron silang tipping point. Okay. Sorry ho, mahaba ho kasi mataba ho tayo.
Saka maupo ka pa rito eh.
Ha?
Maupo ka pa rito eh.
Hindi, pero baka wala na sila para sumagot.
Okay, oh, sige.
Okay, anyway, ganito. Sa ngayon po, nagbago yung formula. Hindi na po everyone against Rojas and the administration. Kung hindi everyone, including the US, Australia, etc., against Duterte. Okay? At yung, alam nyo, ang Pilipino mahilig sa ningas kugon. So ngayon, mataas si Duterte. Pag umupo si Duterte, pwera lang kung ganito ang opening statement niya. Hindi po sa luneta kasi hindi bagay ito. Pero paggising niya, on June 30, meron ng medyang nakabantay sa kanya. Saan man siya natulog? Kung kanino man siya sumiping. No? Ganito po, kung si Duterte itong sinabi, mga kababayan, nagsinungaling po ako. Hindi po ako mamamatay tao. Ginawa ko lang lahat yung pagsisinungaling para manalo. Maraming salamat po. Huwag kayo matakot. Uncle Sam, huwag kayo matakot. Uncle Australia, huwag kayo matakot. Ako po ay gusto ko lang na magkaroon ng presidente na taga Davao, taga Mindanao, taga South. From now on, naka-Amerikana na. Nagpagupit na. Nagpa-ano na. So, whitening lotion.
Ngayon, tuta nyo na ako, ganun.
Well, hindi mo sasabihin yun. Pero implied yun. Okay. Tuta na ako dito. Okay. Ngayon, ang tanong ko, posible bang magkagulo? Dahil mukhang imposible na mahinto yung take-off ni Duterte. Sa tingin ko, ay panalo na si Duterte. Posible bang magkagulo dahil nanalo si Duterte? Hindi dahil nanalo si Marrojas. Salamat po. Sorry for the long question.
Okay. Do you see trouble?
I think mahirap sagutin kung mananalo si Duterte, magkakagulo lahat. Kung manalo si Duterte, ang pinakamahalaga kasi rito, kahit sino sa kanila ang manalo, dapat malinis, malaya, matapat ang proseso ng pagkakapanalo ng sinumang kandidato. Yun yung pinakamahalaga. Kasi ngayon, ang kampanya, laban dun sa mga kandidato na laban sa demokrasya. Pero sa panahon ng botohan, dapat lahat tayong mamamayang Pilipino, igalang natin yung proseso ng pagboboto. So that igalang natin ang bawat mamamayan na bumoboto. Kaya para sa akin, tulad nung nabanggit din kanina, pagka manalo si Duterte, kailangan igalang natin yung proseso. At hindi natin asahan na magkakagulo kasi nanalo si Duterte.
Mm-hmm. Well said. Father?
Ako pare, I have the same response, no? Na you respect the results of this democratic election. No? Kung wala siyang gagawin yung mga what he promised to do na hindi yang gagawin yan, walang problema. No? Kasi you have to respond to every act, di ba? No? Pero there is still something na dapat he has to be accountable. No? Whether he wins or loses. Yun pong buhay ng 1,424 na pinatay ng Davao death squads. He cannot, if he is linked with that, no? Kahit matanda na siya o saan man siya, manalo ba siya o matalo, he has to be held accountable for what happened in Davao. Because no one is above the law. No? Yan po ang my response. Kung yung nangyari sa Davao, as he promised, i-multiply yan, mas lalo pa. No? Because we are going to hold him accountable for whatever he did in the past and whatever he promised to do in the future. No?
Thank you. Please.
Tres Cabrera po.
Pakiayos lang. Pakihawak lang.
The question is ganito.
Pakilala ka raw muna.
Tracy Cabrera po, sa Atawat Police Files Tonight. Ang comment ko lang po dun sa kasi if Duterte is a problem because of the extrajudicial killings, maybe the suggestion is maybe he should be given a taste of his own medicine. Tapos ang question ko ganito ho, food for thought, hindi naging solusyon ang pagpatay sa pagsugpo ng krimen, like drugs and other crimes. Ang nakita ko pong trend sa mundo is through sports. Gaya ng siguro kailangan pag-aralan ng mga presidentiables natin yung program na Football for Peace. Kasi doon nakita ko, ang NPA mismo lumalapit sa militar para ialok ang kanilang mga anak para matutong mag-football at hindi na sundan ang kanilang yapak. Now the question. Ang question ko po is, Duterte is a creation of our society. Kasalanan natin kaya may Duterte. Meron naman mga in-place na batas para mapigil ang drugs, para mapigil ang crime, para mapigil ang corruption. but we allow it to grow. So the question now is, how do we stop a monster like Duterte? How do we really stop him?
Okay. Or if we are to simplify your question, is it because we screwed it? That's why Duterte is here? O parang ganun. Pinabayaan natin.
Well, I think tayo na rin ang nagsasabi eh, di ba? Ang dami nating mga batas, at tama naman yung tanong eh, ang dami nating mga batas, pero hindi pinatutupad ng lubos at ganap. Kaya kanina, yung sinabi ko, na pag pinag-aralan natin, gumawa ako ng research sa mga batas natin, and we have about estimated 30 human rights laws na maaayos na mga batas. Pero itong 30 human rights laws na ito, kasama na rin ang modernization para sa AFP at saka yung pagsasaayos ng DILG, yung rule of law, no? Ganyan. Hanggat hindi natin mapatupad itong mga batas na ito, talagang patuloy ang ganito. So, ano ang pwede natin gawin? Konkreto, para sa akin, yung mga national laws na yan dapat nagiging provincial ordinances sa mga board members, city ordinances, municipal ordinances, down to the barangay level. Dapat merong monitoring system. Kayong mga media, napakaganda ng pagkakataon ninyo para maging kabahagi ng monitoring. Konkretong nararanasan ko yon sa inyo. Church institutions, hindi dapat quiet lamang pagka merong mga ganitong nangyayari. So, ang paglulutas ng problema ay pagpapatupad ng ating mga human rights laws at saka international, yung mga rule of law natin na maaayos, naganap at lubos. Pero, isa yon, pero mapapatupad mo lang ang mga batas kung kabahagi mo, kasama mo, ang mamamayan, ang civil society organizations. Para magawa yan, kinakailangan mamulat sila. So now we talk about the empowerment of the civil society groups with respect to their entitlements, with respect to their rights and their responsibilities. Pag kumilos ang buong mamamayan in a unified voice, in a unified command, walang laban ang mga Duterte.
Yeah. Thank you. Father, would you care to add? Susunod na tayo sa part 2 eh.
Okay, I do not like that question. How do we stop a monster like Duterte, no? Because that's not my primary aim, to stop anybody from being elected, no? But what I want to do is just to tell the truth, no? Ito nangyari, no? And that you have to follow your own conscience, no? Marami na mong namamatay sa Davao. Many have died. I call it mass murder, no? And that someone and some groups have to be held accountable to this, di ba? At the same time, to make everyone aware of the value of life and the value of human rights. Yun lang. No?
Thank you. We have time for brief questions. Dalawa lang, ha? May pass po tayo.
Yes, ma'am. Magandang hapon po.
Please identify yourself.
Ramon De Leon po ng Partido Demokratiko Socialista ng Pilipinas, Chapter Tondo. Tondo for sure, development, dun po sa Tondo. Yeah, with Robert Gonzales. Kahapon po, kagabi na, napanood po namin yung debate ng mga presidente. Masyadong nagsasalita si Mara Rojas ng magagandang ginawa. And yet, sabi ni Duterte, salita ka ng salita dyan eh, nasaan ka ba? Nasa ilalim ka ng tulay. Sabi mo, maganda ang magandang tuwid, matuwid na daan, pero it fell in fact.
Brother, we're getting into politics.
Yes, medyo, ma'am. Yes, sir. Question lang
anong po. Tanong?
Tanong ko lang po. Si Duterte po ay patuloy po siyang bumabango. Ang tanong po sa inyong rekomendasyon, narinig ko lang po si Duterte rito eh. Sino po yung less evil? Sana mag-choose po tayo kung pwede niyo pong irekomenda yung choose less evil.
No, we're not here to endorse. I'm sorry. We will not allow this forum to endorse.
Okay, sir.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
That is our prerogative.
Yes, sir. Yun lang po tanong and thank you very much.
Thank you. Next question.
Good morning po. I'm Elmar Klim from Areopagus Communications. So, Areopagus Communications. Yung question ko po is about po dun sa pagpatay. Then bilang Katoliko, bilang kabataang Katoliko, ang pagpatay ay tinatawag na mortal sin. So my question po is, ano po yung ginawang o ginagawang aksyon ng simbahang Katoliko sa Davao in regards sa bilang ng mga okay. kabataang
Yeah, na we got the question. Thank you. Please.
Under Archbishop Capalia, no, we have meron pong yung pastoral letter, no? Thou shalt not kill. It was read all over the churches at saka marami pa kami mga posters. Lahat ng mga simbahan, lahat ng mga chapel, it was placed there. And we had mga prayer, rallies. No? Kaya even yung launching sa Human Rights Watch report, Archbishop Capalia was there and the priests were all behind that. So, meron kaming ginawa. Yun lang is... marami pa rin ang nag-iisip na, na para bang mas supportive sila yung sa mga killings. But the church has done all it could do. You know. But again, kasi we have to leave each one sa kanilang conscience. Eh, you know?
Thank you. Okay. We cannot ask our panelists to endorse the lesser evil or the least evil among the candidates. What's your prognosis? Very brief statements. Father, magsimula ka at susunod si Professor Eta. Anong nakikita nyo?
You know, it's too early to predict anything. Of course, nangunguna ngayon si Duterte. No? So, well, I would not be surprised if he wins. And I hope it doesn't happen. No? But I'm very realistic. But this is 2 weeks in politics is still a lifetime, no? So anything can still happen, especially yung impact of kanyang mga statements, no? That could still have an effect on this, no? So I'm not going to make a prognosis, but I wouldn't be surprised, no, na the trend is going to continue, but I hope it doesn't okay. happen, but I'm prepared for anything, no?
Okay,
anything that will happen, but we will be there, we'll do our work, our job, our mission of being a prophetic church.
You will not take a boat to Vietnam?
No.
You will stay in the Philippines?
I will stay in the Philippines, although na yung mga ibang pare, mahanap na ka saan ka makatago. No, I'm not going to hide. No.
Okay. Thank you, Father. Professor.
Well, the survey ratings are not very encouraging, of course. Even at the level of the vice presidency, you know, the one who's leading is not really all that encouraging to me. But there's a difference between ratings, survey ratings, and actual voting. So I think that the Filipino people should not be influenced fully because of these survey ratings. Use your conscience, please study, and do the best that you can, you know, for somebody who will serve the people. Now, my prognosis, I have faith in the Filipino people. People are intolerant, people are impatient, etc. But I have faith in the Filipino people, but by and large, they still believe in the rule of law and democracy. But we have to be... accelerate maybe coming together and bringing together the positive forces that believe in truth, justice, and democracy. So whoever wins, if those whom we do not desire to win, we must respect this, but still pursue the rule of law, justice, and democracy.
One last question, answerable by a yes or a no. Professor, do you believe in miracles?
Yes, miracles have happened.
Okay. Thank you. Father?
Of course, I do. No, I was praying for a miracle yung sa EDSA 1, nangyari yon. I was praying for a miracle yung EDSA 2, nangyari yon. No? Now I'm still praying for a miracle. No, that God, who cares about the Filipino people, will
be able to take care of us from all harm. No matter how helpless and hopeless a situation is, in the end, huwag tayong mawala ng pag-asa because evil will not reign.
Okay, tama po yan. At ako hindi nawawala ng pag-asa dahil yung barangay ko sa Quezon City, bagong pag-asa. Babalik po kami with the part 2.